The American Sports Cavalcade is a presentation of Diamond.
We saw new winners at Bristol, old favorites, and more than one heart-stopping finish. Finally, the party weekend was capped by a silver anniversary celebration that had 35,000 fans on their feet and hollering deep into the Appalachian evening. Another unique feature of the IHRA is the final round of qualifying under the lights. And more than once this year, the Night of Fire has been exactly that. Remember Don Kohler in the Night of Fire at Milan, Michigan? Once again at St. Louis Gateway International Racetrack, when 4,000 horsepower exploded out of his top fuel dragster. But perhaps the biggest draws at any IHRA meet are the wild and woolly battles for top sportsmen. Will we top that kind of action at Norwalk, Ohio? ESPN, celebrating its 10th year as world leader in motorsports coverage, presents Speed World.
Norwalk Raceway Park in Norwalk, Ohio, the most beautiful facility in all of drag racing, and today the site of the 12th annual International Hot Rod Association World Nationals. Hello everyone, I'm Bob Varsha, welcoming you to beautiful Norwalk and the beginning of the championship stretch run in our ESPN coverage of the International Hot Rod Association in 1989. Norwalk is not only a beautiful racetrack, it also offers some of the best air in all of drag racing. That makes tuning these monstrous engines a complicated task, and as usual, qualifying tells the tale.
Ted Jones is with us once again, and Ted, qualifying also produced some new faces.
A surprise entry this weekend, Kenny Bernstein and the Budweiser King in Nitro Funny Car. Gene the Snowman Snow from Fort Worth, Texas, the reigning IHRA World Champion, and the battle will heat up between Tricky Ricky Smith and Tim Neighbors, the two big mountain motor cars. The action will be intense in Alcohol Funny Car. This man, Mark Thomas, the world's fastest dairy farmer in his real milk car, is number two in the points. He's chasing desperately after Greg Moss, who has not been able to win an IHRA event this year, but still leads the points in his Thunderbird Alcohol Funny Car.
As usual, four strong pro fields await our attention, and as usual, Ted will also take a look at a sportsman class.
This is the Godzilla 55 Chevrolet of Nick Iarussi. He runs an IHRA's exciting 990 class, or Super Rod Eliminator. We'll be taking a look at that class, Bob.
The monster is loose, not in Tokyo, but in Norwalk, Ohio. Great fun there. Brett Kepner, as usual, is with us to conduct interviews and our special feature on Super Rod. Coming up next, final qualifying at the Night of Fire from the Loctite Nationwise World Nationals, brought to you by Quaker State Motor Oil. The big Q stands for quality, always has, always will. By Firestone, watch us, we're on the move. And by Drag Review Magazine, all you need to know about drag racing. The Night of Fire, coming your way from Norwalk, Ohio. Lots of great drag racing action on the IHRA circuit. Stay. Bob Varsha, Ted Jones, and Brett Kepner with you once again from Norwalk Raceway Park. And as always, the final round of qualifying came during the Night of Fire, where Tim Neighbors pulled an upset in pro stock.
Tim Neighbors turned in the number one qualifying time with this great run, a 7.45, 190.27 miles per hour.
You don't often see a 190 in pro stock, but there's one. And there, as the night settled in, was the look in the grandstands. Tens of thousands of people on their feet to watch the blazing action of Top Fuel and the Nitro Funny Cars going at it under the lights. In the first round, John Kerry gave them a little early fireworks exhibition, spewing parts out of the machine. And then came the matchup of points leader Pat Dakin against Richard Holcomb, one of the first men into the sub-5-second club in Top Fuel.
Well, Holcomb with the Clayton Harris tuned car turned in a brilliant 5.26, 263.13 miles per hour.
Making his debut on the IHRA Tour this year, former world champ Kenny Bernstein up against Tom the Mongoose McEwen in that beautiful 57 Chevy.
Bernstein set the crowd on its ear in the Budweiser Quaker State Buick with a fantastic 5.35, coupled up with 264.71 miles per hour.
Bernstein, the best man in nitro funny car, and in alcohol, Bob Newberry, the first man to break 6 seconds in this class.
Newberry nearly did it again, a 6.19, 231 miles per hour.
But of course, the night of fire means jet cars, and this was something spectacular. In the right lane, Lynn Redmond, but watch the left lane and Bruce McCombs when the lights come on and he puts down the throttle.
Bruce McCombs driving the flash fire jet, and there's a flash fire, Bob.
A lot more than he ever bargained for. Redmond lights the afterburner and scorches away at better than 200 miles an hour. But you know, every eye on the racetrack was on the start line where Bruce McComb was struggling to get out of his flaming racer.
McComb actually stole the show. Bill Bader had engineered a beautiful fireworks show actually down each side of the track, but everyone was watching the starting line. The BTS crew now on the scene trying to get that fire put out.
There you see McCombs being led away at the front of the car, and look at the conflagration raised by that explosive jet fuel.
Those flames actually reaching 30 feet in the air as that car literally melts to the ground. They have a fiberglass body, and when the glass reaches a certain temperature, it begins to melt. The crowd very appreciative of this show.
But it's one that you can only do once, as Bruce McCombs burned flash fire absolutely to the ground. And Brett Kepner was standing by afterwards to talk to the man.
How are you doing? Are you feeling okay?
I'm feeling okay. So my pocketbook took a big one here. My pocketbook.
We're going to have to go.
Thanks a lot.
I tried to put the extinguisher on you.
And in case you couldn't hear him, he said, I'm okay, but my pocketbook took a big one here today.
Well, there's no doubt about it. As we look over the melted body, or what's left of the body, it's turned into silly putty right now. The beautiful flash fire jet is now a molten hulk of, looks like lava or something.
Lava it is. And here's a look once again at what happened to Bruce McComb. Temperatures in the afterburners of these jet cars reaches over 1,000 degrees, and when it caught the fuel supply, the immolation began.
It's actually a double explosion taking place. The fuel tank had ruptured and there was a leak, and jet fuel was pouring out on the ground underneath this car. Of course, McCombs didn't realize it. When he lit that afterburner, he just set the whole thing off. What a blazing inferno, and this without question tops any night of fire so far, Bob.
We'll be back for the first round for nitro burning funny car action. This is your points leader, Doc Holliday.
Well, Doc Holliday and that potent Dodge Daytona against this man, Tony Mack, or Tony McCollum. Tony Mack, the winner of the Spring Nationals, has been a definite force this year, Bob.
And Doc Holliday looking for two in a row. He was a winner at the Gateway Nationals in St. Louis about a month ago. Now he's going up against the only man, a black driver, to win any championship class in the IHRA. Cars get away evenly, but McCallum has traction troubles, and Doc Holliday has a walkover.
Doc Holliday with a great 5.58, 263 miles per hour.
Our next matchup, R.C. Sherman, hoping to run down Holliday in the points. He's up against seven qualifier Al Hoffman.
Hoffman out on top. Here comes Sherman, passes him, and Hoffman shuts it down. An easy win for R.C., 5.51, 273 miles per hour.
And we move on to the next matchup. Number three qualifier, Art Hendy from San Bernardino, California, up against Whit Bazemore of Pensacola, Florida.
Whit Bazemore has been doing a very respectable driving job, and yes, he bumps off Art Hindy. He'll move into the semifinals.
And that is a big upset. Now here is the man, King Kenny Bernstein, in his IHRA debut this season. He comes in as the top qualifier in the Budweiser Quaker State Buick.
He's going against Gary Bolger. Talk about the old and the new. This is a 1978 Mustang with 78 technology against Kenny Bernstein and the triple trick computer control Budweiser King.
Now, Bolger is not driving a fiberglass replica car like Tom McEwen's or Diamond Dave Miller's. This is an actual Mustang. This is in sheet metal, and it looks like he got the whole shot. No, he red lights against King Kenny.
That's right. Same thing we saw earlier in the show. Bolger took a shot at it, didn't make it. Kenny moves into the next round.
And in the next round, he will have lane choice against his opponent, Doc Holliday. That should be a good matchup. R.C. Sherman will have lane choice against surprise Whit Bazemore. And we move on now to the nitro-burning Top Fuel Dragsters. This is Pat Dakin, the points leader out of Dakin, Ohio, climbing those fat Goodyear slicks as he warms the tires during his burnout. His opponent from Columbus, Ohio, construction company owner Jim Head.
Head hasn't been that strong at all this year on the IHRA trail. Dakin, on the other hand, has, he's leading the points. What more can I say? He's been very dominant.
The two cars get away cleanly. Looks like a little bit of a traction problem in the left lane for Head, and Dakin drives around. Good race.
Dakin will move into the next round.
Our next matchup in Top Fuel will be the pride of Boynton Beach, Florida, Paul Smith, the number 8 qualifier, up against one of the fastest Top Fuel drivers in the world, Richard Holcomb.
Paul Smith leaves very early on Holcomb, and Holcomb is going to have his hands full driving around. He does.
Looks like he hurt the race car a little bit, Ted.
There is some smoke there, would indicate that he may have hurt something on that run. A 5:52, a good run. Holcomb, there we see the smoke right there. Holcomb did hurt that engine right before he went into the traps and nearly lost that race to Paul Smith.
So, as you see the flames coming from the cockpit now, looks like there's going to be work for Richard Holcomb's crew. And our final matchup in Top Fuel will be Hank Endres, who comes in out of Pennsville, New Jersey as the number 2 qualifier. He will be up against his former car owner, John Carey from Dover, Delaware.
Well, John Carey qualified number 7. Hank Endres qualified number 2. So Endres has to be the odds-on favorite to take this round.
Endres now driving for Jim and Sue Bernstein out of Pennsville, New Jersey. Carey in the left lane, Endres in the right. Remember that left lane where we had that big jet burn down? Maybe giving these cars some really awkward launches, but look at this. Endres in the right lane goes up, and John Carey will walk through to the semis.
Carey with a 5:51.238. The Norwalk Raceway Park crew stayed up all night working that lane over. We'll see it right now as they come out, and you'll see instantly Carey will go up in smoke in what should be the good lane. The lane where the jet car burned to the ground last night is the better of the two lanes right now.
Our final run in Top Fuel will be a solo effort. Here's Gene Snow coming back after breaking his collarbone a couple of months ago in California. He gets a solo when his opponent Bob Murray fails to show.
There's a possibility, obviously, with 3 more races to go, that you can still drive around Pat Dakin for the World Championship. Is that still on your mind coming back from your crash?
I was looking at the numbers the other day. I think we're maybe less than 100 points apart, and I think it's going to be real close, and we can't afford to let him get ahead of us too much more.
I know you'll be charging. Good luck, guy.
Thanks very much.
Charging into the semifinals will be Gene Snow, although he will give up lane choice to John Carey in one matchup. Richard Holcomb will have lane choice over points leader Pat Dakin in the second. Plenty of action still to come. Back at the Loctite Nationwise IHRA World Nationals, Bob Barsha, Ted Jones, and Brett Kepner with you. There was R.C. Sherman and his opponent in the semifinals of nitro-burning funny car, the pristine white machine of Whit Bazemore.
Whit Bazemore out of Pensacola, Florida, surprised to even be in the semifinals. This is his rookie year in a nitro funny car, especially against this man. This is the high-dollar car owned by Nick Bonifani and sponsored by Raybestos Clutches.
Reaction time's about equal for the two drivers in the quarterfinals. Bazemore will be on the left, R.C. Sherman on the right. The cars are staged and ready. And Bazemore does not move. R.C. Sherman has a walkover.
Bazemore breaks right on the starting line. The Raybestos car, a 5:52, 264 mile per hour, an easy trip to the finals.
And there is Bazemore idling down the quarter mile. Our next matchup, Doc Holliday in the left lane, Kenny Bernstein in the right.
Well, this is pressure for the doctor. Remember, he's the points leader. He's seen RC go into the finals. He needs to bump off the big Budweiser King car.
Doc Holliday hoping to become a world champion despite the fact that his Telstar Dodge is not sponsored. Clean getaway for both cars. Quickly, Bernstein opens up a car length advantage and holds it to the end, but barely.
Barely indeed. Kenny Bernstein, a slower 564. Doc Holliday was late off the starting line by a ton. Watch, Doc sets there. Bernstein has already left. Here they come down the quarter mile now. Doc Holliday is actually ahead of Bernstein. At the eighth mile, Bernstein applies the Dale Armstrong wrenched horsepower and moves around Doc for the win.
Well, Kenny Bernstein definitely dejected. Although he picked up the semifinal round win, some obvious engine problems. And Kenny, that one was one, if nothing else, with serious, serious driving abilities. And apparently it is that severe, huh?
Yeah, I broke a rod in it. Yeah, it broke bad.
Your reaction time was all that wanted. It was a 564 to a losing 561 for Doc.
Well, just got lucky. Some days you get those and some days you don't. I've had them on the other side, but... You know, it just, we hate tearing stuff up like that, but that's the way sometimes it goes.
You know, every run that you and Dale Armstrong make with this car and your crew is an experiment. You're always trying new things. I know this weekend you were trying a lot of new things. Could this be an experiment gone awry?
No, this wasn't at all. This was normal here, normal engine combination, normal clutch. All we're doing now is trying to win a race, and that's it. But, you know, obviously something was wrong internally, and it gave up.
You got a lot of work. We'll let you go. Good luck.
A lot of work to do. Thanks.
A lot of work indeed for Kenny Bernstein and crew chief Dale Armstrong, true innovators in nitro-burning funny cars. It'll be Bernstein against R.C. Sherman. Sherman, by virtue of the quicker ET, will have lane choice in the nitro funny car final. We move on now to semifinal action in Top Fuel. And a matchup will feature Gene Snow, the two-time and defending IHRA world champion, going up against John Carey.
Gary, the diesel mechanic out of Dover, Delaware, defeated Hank Indries to move into this round against the world champ Gene Snow. You can bet Pat Dakin is watching this run, Bob.
Pat Dakin, the points leader in the other semifinal. Remember, this man, Gene Snow, still nursing that broken collarbone. He let up in his quarterfinal round, gave up lane choice to John Carey in order to get this far, but Snowman with a great start. He's got a car length, and he extends it to the finish.
Well, Snow off the line first. Look at the ET, 514, 260 mile per hour. The Snowman is back indeed.
Well, Gene, you had said you thought 520s might be the order of the day. Everything's stationary there. 514 at 260 miles an hour, I think, is a little bit quicker than even you thought it was going to go.
Yeah, it was. I had no idea what we did on the first round, and... That felt about the same. It was really good. Johnny had a good close race.
It appears that you're back to your tradition of shutting it off early to keep from damaging anything. Is there anything left in this thing? Well, we got a wetter front coming in that may change the atmosphere.
Maybe. I noticed it changed a little bit a while ago, but the thing about it is I got to watch his shoulder. We got to be careful. We shut off a little early so I'll have time to slow down before we hit both chutes.
The injury from the accident has slowed down your reactions a little bit, I guess, is your concern.
Probably, but if I can keep the car running good, we're going to be okay.
That's for sure. Congratulations.
See
you in the final.
Thanks very much. Okay.
Wow, a 514 and he eased up. That'll give these guys something to think about. And Pat Dakin's crew has got something on their hands.
They're adjusting the valve cover right there. Meanwhile, Richard Holcomb getting ready to stage. Clayton Harris, the crew chief, looking at starter Jim Blakely saying, what's going on? What's the problem? Let's stage him up.
These nitro-burning cars heat up awfully quickly, and they cannot sit idling in the staging area for very long or they'll burn something.
Now Jim Blakely, the starter, motioning Dakin, get into the lights and stage. The heat's building up over here in the Holcomb car. Here comes the crew chief, that's G.L. Ruff. He reaches in, tells Dakin not to go. It'll be a single run.
Oh, that was a close moment, too, because Ruff stepped forward just as the lights flashed. But apparently, Dakin is done, and Holcomb walks through to the final. There is the points leader. Disappointing moment for him. And so Gene Snow, by virtue of that scintillating 514 ET, will have lane choice over Richard Holcomb in the final. Let's catch up with Brett Kepner in the Pro Stock pits.
Well, the crowd around Jerry Bascom's pit area in the Pro Stock pits seems to be getting larger by every round, and rightfully so. The crew is right now concerned mostly with the clutch. They're adding weight on the clutch, hoping to get the car to launch a little bit harder, I would imagine, against Larry Morgan. As the crew puts in a different pressure plate, adjusting the pressure of that clutch, crew chief Wayne Pilkhurst is looking on. And Wayne, this is a whole new act for everybody. We all know that, but what's the game plan against Morgan?
Well, I think we're just going to add a little more clutch to it and see if we can leave the starting line better.
Well, obviously, it's going to be a close battle. You did lose lane choice, but the cars are only a hundredth of a second apart.
Yeah, I think it's going to be a driver's battle right now.
And what do you think about this Cinderella story?
I'm loving every minute of it.
And rightfully so. This crew is definitely working every minute of it.
And so as Jerry Bascom's crew prepares their man for the semifinal round of pro stock competition. Back at beautiful Norwalk Raceway Park in Norwalk, Ohio, where we're ready for semifinal action in pro stock competition. It'll be Jerry Yeoman from Galena, Kansas, going up against the pride of Davie, Florida, Pat Musi. Meanwhile, Brett Kepner is busy in the pit area.
When Geddy Bernstein told us down at the finish line after his semifinal victory that he had serious problems, we knew he did. But back here in the pit area, it is amazing what his crew has managed to do. Here's the motor they just took out of the Budweiser King Buick Riata, and you can see where at least one connecting rod came right through this aluminum Chrysler Hemi block, destroying the oil pan, the engine block itself. The crew hasn't even bothered taking the cylinder heads off this thing to find out what's wrong. They've already installed a brand new aluminum power plant for Geddy Bernstein's final round appearance against R.C. Sherman. Mike Guger and crew chief Dale Armstrong and the rest of the crew have done the incredible by putting a motor in this thing in less than 20 minutes. But indeed, that's what Geddy Bernstein pays these guys for, to be the absolute best.
And best they are. Meanwhile, back in the staging area, it is Musi against Yeoman in our first semifinal matchup of pro stock.
Pat Musi turned in a very respectable 7.55 in the last round. Yeoman has gotten into this round on two red lights, Bob.
And Yeoman lift the front wheels off the launching pad. Musi drives around.
Musi dominating again, a 7.54, 184 miles per hour.
And so Pat Musi moves into the finals in pro stock, and we'll see now who will be his opponent. Will it be this man, Jerry Bascom? We've said it before, the Cinderella story of the meet. In his first IHRA national event, he's in the semis against this man, the vastly experienced Larry Morgan out of Newark, Ohio.
Bascom is the hometown hero. He's from nearby Bedford Heights, Ohio.
Cars are staged, up come the RPMs, and there's a red light. Jerry Bascom, red lights, and the Cinderella story has reached midnight. Too bad. He gets there first, but it's all for naught. Larry Morgan will advance to the Pro Stock Final against Pat Musi, and he will have lane choice by virtue of the faster ET. On now to Alcohol Funny Cars semi-final action, and what you're going to see next could be a battle for the championship in IHRA competition. Mark Thomas, the dairy farmer from Louisville, Ohio, and his opponent will be the points leader, Greg Moss. Right now, let's catch up with Brett Kepner in the pits.
It's important to remember that in IHRA Championship Drag Racing, competitors have limited amount of time between competition rounds, and that's why there's a thrash at both Kenny Bernstein and Richard Holcomb's pit area. They're trying to get these things ready for the final round championship. And what a better man to ask about Richard Holcomb's problems than the crew chief, the one and only Clayton Harris down underneath the motor. Clayton is always thrashing on this thing, it seems, but Clayton, you like to tear this thing completely down between rounds, even if it's basic maintenance.
Yes, sir. That's the only way you can tell, Brent, where you have anything wrong. You can tune with that till you look at the bearings and check the bottom end. You know how much more pressure it'll stand, and it's a good tuning tool.
He just pulled out the only piston you believe was damaged because of that spark plug coming out of the cylinder head. How bad is it?
Right. We lost number two spark plug out on the starting line, so it only had seven cylinders. And it overloaded number six. It's not bad. We'll be right back.
Have to replace the cylinder head?
No, just one piston and put a helicoil in the spark plug hole.
So you'll be doing that. We'll see you out there, guy.
Very good. Thank you.
Wow, talk about emergency surgery. Limited amount of time and a lot of work to get done. Meanwhile, back in the staging area once again, it is Thomas against Moss, and these guys will decide the world championship.
They could very well decide it here. Oh, Moss almost clipped Thomas. Thomas shuts it down. Greg Moss with an easy win. He'll move into the finals with a 661, 218 miles per hour. But we've got to have another look at that, Bob. Look at the car hopping and jumping. Thomas has lost control. Now Moss starts moving over in the middle. Almost crossed that center line and clipped Thomas. Stayed off of it, though, and managed to get the car straightened out. Moved on for the win.
Wow, what a heart attack, as Greg Moss, the points leader, might have been looking out his window at the tribulations of the man in the right lane, Mark Thomas, but Thomas shuts it off and Moss moves on to the final and hopes to add to his points lead. There he will meet Bob Newberry, who had an easy time of it when Ronnie Midyet fouled, and Newberry will keep lane choice over Moss when they meet in the Alcohol Funny Car Final. Now here's Brett Kepner with a track back brought to you by Quaker State Motor Oil. The big Q stands for quality. Always has, always will.
One of the main goals of any International Highway Association event is the safety of the competitors on the racetrack. But there's another aspect of the safety of this operation at IHRA races that a lot of people never see. That's the mobile hospital unit that's usually located directly behind the timing tower at IHRA events. Well, this vehicle is an amazing piece of equipment in that it is fully staffed. It has virtually every type of equipment that could be used for any medical emergency. It's virtually an emergency room on wheels.
That's exactly right. The vehicle's been modified to provide an emergency care unit that is essentially the same as a fully staffed emergency room at a level 2 hospital. It's staffed with board certified emergency room physicians or surgeons, nurses and paramedics. So we have a representation of all the disciplines that are involved with acute and emergency management of medical issues.
With so many people attending IHRA events throughout the year, it's amazing that this crew isn't more busy than they already are. But no matter whether you're a spectator, a racer, a crewman, even one of the IHRA officials, it seems like everybody is covered in an IHRA race thanks to this incredible mobile hospital unit.
Thank you, Brett, and hopefully we never have to see it used. Final round action coming on action in pro stock, and the upsets have continued. The number 11 qualifier, Pat Musi, has come all the way to the final round to face the number 9 qualifier, Larry Morgan.
Morgan turned in a very respectable 750 in the previous round. Pat Musi could only muster a 754. So Musi has to find 400ths of a second somewhere, Bob.
Well, that just shows you how close the competition is in pro stock, that these guys were so close to the top qualifiers that virtually all of the guys in the top half of the draft got knocked off, and it looks like Musi has fouled in the final round. Larry Morgan will have a walk over to the championship.
Musi was trying to get that 400s out of the tree and couldn't do it, so Larry Morgan wins pro stock eliminator here today.
We move on now to Nitro Funny Car, where you're going to see R.C. Sherman, who is hoping to make up ground on points leader Doc Holliday, who is already out of the competition. He lost in the semifinals to Kenny Bernstein, and that is who R.C. Sherman will face right now.
Well, on Bernstein's mind has to be a problem. It's called ET. Bernstein ran a 564 in the most previous round, but hurt the engine. R.C. Sherman ran a 552.
Both cars away clean. Little bobble there for Bernstein in the left lane, and they go right to the line. Too close to call. The electronic timer says
R.C. Sherman. Sherman upsets Bernstein in the final of 550, 268 miles per hour. Bernstein a losing 554. Look at this rerun. Bernstein out first, goes up into smoke coming off the concrete pad. Still ahead of Sherman, though. Sherman in the last 50 feet will pull it out by inches.
I know you gotta be happy.
Yeah, we are. Especially for Ray Bestis and Pontiac and the crew, especially. Doug Dragoo and Pat Murphy and Bill Pantier and all the guys that have helped, especially for Nick Bonifant, because this car hasn't used a part all weekend.
It was another 550 round, 254 miles an hour. Bernstein did smoke the tires fairly heavily, haze the tires at least, about 200 feet down. But from that point on, this thing never wavered.
I know. I knew that the consistency was going to win it for us, and I knew that if I tried to outrun him, it was going to bite us.
I'll tell you, it was a very happy crew coming, and I got to admit that you told us in the pits that that's the way you were going to handle it, was with consistency, and it worked.
Nothing like knocking off the king of the hill to make your day. Now in alcohol funny cars, Greg Moss, who has already put away his points rival Mark Thomas, will go into the final against probably the fastest man in the class anywhere in the country, Bob Newberry.
Well, Newberry in the Wheels Discount Auto Supply car has Moss covered by 4/10 of a second.
Newberry in the left lane, Moss in the right lane, and this should be a great drag race. Both cars away cleanly. Newberry gets the front wheels in the air a little bit. They are side by side as they head for the lights, and Newberry takes it.
What a top-end charge. Take a look at the speed on this, 225 miles per hour, and you saw it in the last 200 feet. Couples up with a 625 to win the Alcohol Funny Car Championship here today.
Greg definitely gave me a driving lesson. But thank God we had the power today and we calmed it down enough and didn't shake the tires, and 625 was good enough.
It's still amazing to think that 620s are so conservative for you.
Well, the track just has so much heat in it. I mean, we wanted to get after it and maybe try to run an O or maybe even quicker, but one round at a time and just be a consistent race car, and a 625, like I said, was good enough.
So Newberry beats Moss, and that will put Mark Thomas back in the championship hunt. We move on to Top Fuel now, where Gene Snow, the defending world champion, will take on Richard Holcomb.
Snow turned in that brilliant 514 on the last round. Richard Holcomb only ran a 552.
Two members, in fact, two of the earliest members of the sub-5-second club in Top Fuel Racing, good look there. The eyes are the window to the soul, and the snowman right now wants this victory. He needs it to try to overhaul the idol Pat Dakin for the IHRA World Championship. Both cars away cleanly. Snowman getting a little sideways, but the tires go up in smoke on Holcomb's car, and that's the difference.
Gene Snow, a 5.22, 267 miles per hour. Holcomb was out way early on Snow, but Snow had the ET and the power when Holcomb went up in smoke.
As the happy crew goes down to collect their man, let's take another look, and Holcomb's tires go up quickly.
There you see the smoke as he comes right off the end of that concrete pad, the same thing Kenny Bernstein did on his final run, and that's all Gene Snow needed to move around him to take the championship. One elated crew.
It's just like old times. You're gone for one race, and everybody says, gee, Gene Snow's back. Well, I guess you're definitely back. 5.22, 267 miles an hour. A little bit of tire smoke from Richard Holcomb prevented it from being any closer.
I tell you what, he was out in front of me a little bit. I wasn't surprised that, I was surprised he didn't win, really.
And with that victory, Gene Snow creeps up on Pat Dakin for the Top Fuel World Championship. We'll be back to see how close they are when we summarize all explosive night of fire. Ted Jones, we certainly had a great afternoon on the racetrack.
We did indeed, and that means the point situation has tightened up considerably. For instance, in Top Fuel, we see that Gene Snow has moved within 390 points of leader Pat Dakin. In Nitro Funny Car, only 100 points separating the first and second place men. And in Alcohol Funny Car, Mark Thomas moves closer to Greg Moss. In Pro Stock, Tim Neighbors and Ricky Smith continue to have a battle that'll move on to Darlington.
And we'll be bringing you coverage of the Tosti Asti Spumanti U.S. Open Nationals from Darlington Sunday, November 12th at 12:30 p.m. Eastern Time. ESPN Speed World coverage of the World Nationals has been brought to you by Firestone. Watch us, we're on the move. By Quaker State Motor Oil, the big Q stands for quality, always has.